So, what's up sa inyo mga boss, madama na. Ngayong araw, magbablog tayo at gagawin natin yung pinapagawa ni Sir Yui sa social psychology. And i-explain natin yung mamaya, detail by detail, para matutunan din natin kung about saan nga yung constitutional reform and ano yung connection nun sa role theory. Ngayon kasi may ginagawa pa ako, kaya baka mamaya ako papagawa yung video. And ayun, nagpapakain pa kasi ako ng isda. Ito, pakita ko sa inyo. Yan, huwag kayo lulusong dyan, may buhay dyan.
Gago!
So, mayon babalik ako. Out. Ayan, I'm back. Welcome sa vlog. Ayan, pasensya na kung may mga mayroonig kayong ingay, ngay na may pumupukpok. Ayan, pwede din natin pupukin yung mga yan. So, may mga tumitilao. Ayan, kidding aside. Pag-uusapan naman natin ngayon yung constitution reform. Ano ba yung connection nito sa role theory? At ano ba yung magiging epekto nito sa behavior ng tao sa ating society? Ayun. Ngayon, una natin pag-uusapan is constitution reform. Ano nga ba yung nasa loob nito? Isa na dito yung i-extend yung term ni Duterte from 2016, tama ba? To 2030, which is a bad thing para sa mga opposition. So kasi, ang Pilipinas kasi, natrauma na to noong panahon ni Ferdinand Marcos, which is nag-conduct siya ng martial law and madaming naabuso dito, may nag-torture, may mga nawawala hanggang ngayon, and yun. Lalo na yung sa mga na-torture noon, may epekto din to siguro sa kanilang mental health. Kasi maaaring isipin nila, ay baka maulit na naman yung martial law noon, yung panahon Marcos, di ba? Panahon ni Marcos. Ngayon naman, sa behavior, yung mga tao maaaring mag-rally. Kasi madaming against din kay Duterte ngayon. Dahil nga, medyo pumapalpak na siya. Imbis na magtrabaho sila, mag-shift sila from rally. Yan yan, magiging violente ang maaaring maging violente ang rally. Gagaya nung nangyari sa Hong Kong. Maganda example yung nangyari sa Hong Kong. Kasi lahat ng tao sa kanila, imbis na magtrabaho, nag-rally sila, nag-protesta laban sa kanilang gobyerno. Ngayon naman, sa role theory naman, ang isa din kasi sa nakapaloob sa constitution reform is ang federalism. Kumbaga, may gagawing state. Kunwari, gagaya sa Amerika, may mga Ohio state, mga ganun. Sa Pilipinas, parang magiging ganun din siya. Parang may sariling gobyerno ang bawat state. Gaya ng kunwari, tayo, gawin natin state ang Laguna. Ayan, Laguna state. May sarili tayong government. Parang ganun. And syempre, may national government din, which is yung malas sa Malacanang. Ang mangyayari dito kasi, ito maganda based sa role theory. Ito maganda example sa role theory. Kunwari, sa isang state, iba ang batas. Dumura sa behavior din to. Sa ibang state, iba ang batas. Kumbaga, ang pagdura, may multa, 5,000 pesos sa Laguna. Tapos sa Manila naman, dumura, walang multa. So ngayon, galing ka sa Manila, syempre, dumudura ka kung saan-saan. Ano mo na yon, behavior mo na yun. Parang lagi mo na siyang ginagawa. Tapos pumunta ka sa Laguna ngayon. Ngayon, pagpunta mo sa Laguna, dumura ka. At nagtaka ka, bakit ka hinuhuli ng mga tao? Hinuhuli ka ng mga pulis? Tinititingin ka ng mga tao? Ngayon, iba kasi yung norm sa magkabilang panig. Sa Manila kasi, okay lang dumura. Kasi walang multa eh. Sa Laguna naman, pwedeng dumura. Ay, bawal dumura kasi may multa. Ganun, ayun ang epekto nun. Kumbaga, magkaiba sila ng behavior kasi iba, parang magiging iba yung culture nila parehas. So, yun. Tapos sa role theory din, siguro, dadami yung mga tao na mag-iiba ng role. Kumbaga, kasi pag binago natin yung pamamahala natin ngayon, kung gawin natin federalism, makakailangan ng maraming tao sa government. Kasi may kada state may sarili na silang government and maraming magbabago ng role. Mag-shift sila sa government kasi mas maganda ang benefits talaga dun. So yun. Ngayon naman, pupunta naman tayo dun sa pinaka loob ng aming topic. At i-explain namin lahat-lahat ng ito about sa constitution reform. Ayun. Babalik kami. Constitutional reform has been a hot topic that easily scattered here in our country since President Rodrigo Duterte flashed a news about his desire of changing the constitution. Many people have been in shock and different opinions has been uttered since this news bombarded last month, August 2020. Constitutional reform is a progress or change in a country that needs the people's decisions and choices. The problem is, many people and other professionals disagree with that kind of concept or idea since we are currently experiencing pandemic due to COVID-19. According to Attorney Yusinko, it is said that this implementation of the new constitutional reform is in a wrong timing since the government should be handling the solutions for preventing the increased number of positive cases here in the Philippines, wherein we should be tackling this and not going through circles with different issues that can be handled after the current issue, which is the COVID-19 pandemic. In this issue, our roles are really significant since every citizen or even children has their own role to make the country keep moving forward. We should be knowing our roles even at this point since we are a citizen of this country. Role theory can be applied in this issue since we are tackling not just the changes in the constitution here in the Philippines, but this also plays a big part to us. As individuals, we shouldn't just do what the society wants and we should play our own roles as a part of being a Filipino citizen. According to Pulse Asia survey, it shows that 57% of the Filipinos claim that they only have a little knowledge about the constitutional reform. So, how can they implement something knowing that many citizens in the society aren't fully aware of this? Now, let's go to the pros and cons of federally set up. Number 1. Encourages local initiatives. Federalism permits diversity, and local governments may deal directly with local problems. The entire nation is not straitjacketed with a uniform policy to which every state and community must conform. State and local governments may be better suited to deal with specific state and local problems. Number 2. Pursuit of local goals. Federalism helps manage conflict, permitting states and communities to pursue their own policies reduces the pressures that would build up. Federalism permits citizens to decide many things at the state and local levels of government and avoid battling over single national policies to be applied uniformly throughout the land. Number 3. Allows for power redistribution. Federalism disperses power. The widespread distribution of power is generally regarded as a protection against tyranny. To the extent that pluralism thrives in the United States, state and local governments that have contributed to its success. State and local governments also provide a political base for the survival of the opposition party when it loses national elections. Number 4. Increases political participants. Federalism increases political participation. It allows more people to run for and hold political office. In the US, nearly 1 million people hold some kind of political office in the counties, cities, townships, school districts, and special districts.
These local leaders are often regarded as closer to the people than Washington officials. Public opinion polls shows that Americans believe that their local governments are more manageable and responsive than the national government. Number 5. Cuts red tape. Federalism improves efficiency. Even though we may think of 80,000 governments as inefficient, governing the entire nation from Washington would be even worse. Imagine the bureaucracy, red tape, delays, and confusion if every government activity in every community in the nation, police, schools, roads, fire departments, garbage collections, sewage disposal, street lighting, and so on, were controlled by a central government. Even in the Soviet Union were centralized, discipline and party control are a matter of political ideology. Leaders have been forced to resort to decentralization simply as a practical matter. Moreover, federalism encourages experimentation and innovation in public policy in the states.
Opponents of federalism have cited the following disadvantages. Number 1. Protects special interest groups. Federalism allows special interests to protect their privileges. For many years, segregationists used the arguments of states' rights to avoid federal laws designed to guarantee equality and prevent discrimination. Number 2. Uneven distribution of benefits. Federalism allows the benefits and costs of government to be spread unevenly. Some states spend more than twice as much as the other states on education. Even in the same state, some wealthy schools spend 2 or 3 times as much as the poorer districts. The taxes in some states are much higher than the other states. Number 3. Creates disadvantages in poorer states and communities. Poorer states generally provide lower levels of education, health, and welfare services, police protection, and environmental protection than wealthier states and communities. Number 4. Obstructs action on national issues. For many years, decentralizing the issue of civil rights allowed segregation to flourish in America. Minorities can usually expect better treatment by national agencies than by state or local authorities. Manila, Philippines lawmakers on Sunday rejected the insistence of the DILG on introducing amendments to the Constitution for economic and political reform, amid the national struggle to contain the spread of the new coronavirus in the country. They should focus more on the safety and food security of the people, he said, adding that he believed President Duterte did not order the DILG to pursue the push for constitutional amendments. This is not the right time to push for charter change through a signature campaign, whether physical or online, Cagayan Representative Rufus Rodriguez, chair of the Constitutional Amendments Committee of the House Representatives, told the Inquirer in a text message. Also, charter change is a very contentious issue, and we don't want to divide our people on this matter at this time, said Rodriguez, whose committee was deliberating on proposals to amend or revise the 1987 Constitution before the pandemic. The Inquirer learned during the weekend that the DILG had not dropped its constitutional amendment and, in fact, had directed its regional offices and supporters to continue gathering 2 million signatures over the next 2 months. The DILG plans to present the 2 million signatures to both houses of Congress to show the lawmakers that it has the support in the regions in pushing for constitutional reforms. So that's it guys for today. By the way, my name is Louise Joy Tadeo and I'm from BS Psychology, Psych 502. And what do you guys think about our topic? You can comment your ideas down below. So like, share, and subscribe and click the notification bell. Thank you!